There is no such thing as a tree, at least scientifically speaking. Like, obviously there's trees, you've seen trees, but there's no tree category in the taxonomic classification of plants. Rather, a tree is a strategy. It's a life history. It's a shape a plant takes on to increase its access to sunlight. And the idea is basically the same no matter the species. Grow one tall, woody stem to support the rest of the plant as it grows taller in its quest for light. But after that, like, all the rules are out the window in the looks department. Anything and everything is fair game. So the resulting trees can wind up looking pretty wild. We have to share this with you, so in this episode we're going to cover the world's weirdest looking plants that have grown into trees, from rainbow bark to fruiting trunks to blood-colored sap. This first tree is what happens when Seuss books get printed in color. Commonly referred to as the rainbow eucalyptus, it gets its name due to the literal rainbow of colors on its trunk that look like they were just painted on there. It's the only eucalyptus species that is not native to Australia, instead found in the more humid climates of Indonesia and the Philippines. Now, the science behind this kaleidoscope of colors is related to a strategy shared by many eucalyptus trees. They shed their bark in strips throughout the year. Unlike most other trees, which allow their bark to build up in layers, it is hypothesized that eucalyptus shed their bark in big, long strips to stop other plants or parasites from growing on the bark. It may also be a strategy to allow the tree trunk to photosynthesize by exposing chlorophyll in the new tissue. And it's that last thing that might explain the rainbow eucalyptus's colorful bark. The peeling exposes new stem growth that is bright green due to the chlorophyll. On top of this layer of chlorophyll, it is hypothesized that there is a very thin layer of cells that start clear but slowly fill up with reddish-brown chemicals called tannins, produced by the tree to protect against predation. These tannins continue to build up while the bright green chlorophyll degrades, and at the same time, the bark continues to peel off in strips. So the tree trunk continues to change colors from green to red to purple to brown, never having the same pattern twice. But the most surprising thing about this tree may not be its colorful bark. No, it is that it is widely used to make white paper, even being the main source for it in the Philippines, which is not what I would have expected. Banyan trees can look like an entire forest, but they are really just one tree that grows from the top down. As the canopy of this tree spreads out horizontally, the branches send out aerial roots. These are a kind of root that grows above the ground and are used by the plant for climbing and for nutrient uptake. You've probably seen aerial roots growing on other plants like monsteras, orchids, and mangroves. But banyan tree aerial roots are special because if they touch the ground, they become another trunk to help support the massive weight of the tree's canopy. A large banyan tree can have lots of these support trunks, giving it the appearance of an entire forest. Banyans are the world's biggest trees in terms of how much space they cover. The largest specimen is found in India, and it covers almost 5 acres. Not only do they provide shelter and an enormous amount of habitat for lots of creatures, the aerial roots also support the soil by preventing soil erosion. It might come as a surprise to learn that banyans are a type of fig tree, figs being one of the most successful and sometimes bizarre groups of plants out there. Specifically, they are a type of fig known as a strangler fig because the seeds start out by rooting into another tree. And then they literally strangle the host tree as the fig tree grows bigger and sends down more aerial roots. It's like a tree that eats trees. And a study published in 2020 looked into why banyan trees have these aerial roots. They compared the genome of a Chinese banyan species with another related fig species that does not grow aerial roots. Researchers found that the banyan genome had duplications in it, increasing the number of genes that make plant growth hormones. This increase in plant growth hormones is what causes the aerial roots to grow in banyan trees. However, they don't make all that extra growth hormone just for bragging rights or those massive aerial roots. Rather, the duplicated sections also contain genes that make organic compounds used to signal the tree's pollinators, which are tiny parasitic wasps. Each fig tree has a specific wasp pollinator that clues into the smelly compounds produced by that tree. No two fig species' scents are alike. So really, the aerial roots are kind of added bonus for the banyan tree. The next tree, the jabuticaba, does something even more unexpected with its trunk. It just grows fruit on it. The fruits look like plums in both size and appearance, and while I have not been able to try one myself, they are supposed to taste like a Concord grape, which sounds delicious. Native to Brazil, the tree's fruiting strategy is known as cauliflore. Cauliflore is where flowers and fruit are produced directly from nodes on the stems or trunks, which sounds made up. It sounds like it's from a storybook. But it's actually a more common plant strategy than you might think, and some figs also do this, proving once again that figs are built different. However, the jabuticaba takes this cauliflore to the extreme by sprouting white flowers that turn into purple fruits all over, especially on the tree trunk. Now, there are a few hypotheses kicking around as to why this tree has developed this particular strategy. Mine is that it just wanted to be a little different. You know, you're a teenager, you want to try new stuff. One thought is that it helps with seed dispersal. Any creature wandering by has easy access to a delicious snack, like tortoises that live in the area who eat the fallen fruit, but can also snag a fresh one right off the trunk. In fact, in support of this theory, the fruit growing high up in the tree is hidden by the leaves, whereas the fruit on the trunk is out in the open, ripe for the taking. Pun intended. But in other cauliflower species, like figs, this theory has been debated, and another hypothesis has been floated. One that makes a lot of sense for this funky tree as well: nutrients. When fruit growing on the trunk ripens and falls off, it will land much closer to the base of the tree than any fruit growing on the branches. Anything left uneaten will rot and send nutrients into the ground for the tree to use the next growing season, like its own little compost bin. Regardless of the reason, the jabuticaba's unique strategy for growing fruit sets it apart from other trees and earns it a well-deserved spot on this list.
This SciShow video is supported by Magellan TV, a documentary streaming service founded by filmmakers. Since you watch SciShow, you're bound to love their in-depth science stories, from space to technology to nature. But they also offer collections on history, true crime, travel, and more. So you'll never run out of something to watch, especially with their hours of new content added every week. And that's all ad-free. That means you get to watch the 6 episodes of Global Science Groundbreaking Achievements without interruption. In this series, you can learn about the cutting-edge science around the world in the fields of space, medicine, tech, and more. And I know it's called Magellan TV, but you can take your pick of watching it on your television, laptop, or mobile device. It's compatible with Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Apple TV, Google Play, and iOS. So you can really watch it anytime, anywhere. With an annual membership, you just pay $4.99 per month for 3,500 hours worth of documentaries. And as a SciShow viewer, you'll get a 1-month free trial on Magellan TV by clicking on the link in the description.
This next oddly shaped tree is beloved by many, and may be the most famous weird-looking tree on this list. It's the baobab. These trees are native to Africa and Oceania. However, a genetic study found that all 8 baobab trees can trace their origin specifically back to the island of Madagascar. And if you think their trunks look swollen, it's because they are swollen. They are adapted to store huge amounts of water under dry conditions because they are a succulent. You know, those little desk plants that you've tried and failed to keep alive one too many times. It's okay, you can admit it. I've been there. I'm not a good plant dad. The word succulent refers to a type of plant that is capable of storing water in its leaves, stems, or roots, which is exactly what the baobab does. Their trunks expand with water during periods of heavy rain. Unfortunately, some of these species are now threatened, with climate change making things too dry, even for these trees adapted for water storage. Another familiar yet strange tree from halfway across the world from the baobab is the Joshua tree. Joshua trees have been around for a long time, since the late Pleistocene seen around 2.6 million years ago, and they had a much wider range back then than they do now. Back then, they relied on bear-sized sloths to distribute their seeds. But now they rely on a much smaller creature for reproductive success: a moth. While the moths don't carry the seeds from the tree, that would be a very strong moth, their larvae help out with pollination. Female yucca moths lay eggs inside the Joshua tree flower, which provides a nutrient-rich space for their larvae to grow up. At the same time, the larvae help move pollen up to the stigma of the flower. But seed dispersal isn't the only way a Joshua tree reproduces. The Joshua tree is found in dry locations like the Mojave Desert, where rainfall is scarce, and the tree has an extensive extensive system of underground stems called rhizomes that help them access water. But they're also a way for the tree to reproduce asexually. New Joshua trees can grow up from the rhizomes instead of waiting on the right growth conditions for their seeds to germinate. This seems to happen as a response to cold temperatures. In one instance, a Joshua tree's rhizomes were found 11 meters, or 36 feet away from the closest Joshua tree, the one that most likely grew them. This lets genetically identical new shoots poke up out of the ground in a wide radius, and it means that two Joshua trees growing in the vicinity of each other are more than likely to be the same individual. And finally, the last tree on the list. Native to Yemen, the Dracaena dragon's blood tree makes the list based on looks alone, resembling a giant inside-out umbrella. But as the name suggests, there is more to this tree than just an unusual shape. And that is because when you cut into the trunk, it bleeds, presumably to make you run away screaming and never do that again. The tree has to be damaged in order to produce this blood, and while it's not actually blood, that is a pretty good analogy. It's actually a resin produced as a defense mechanism against injury and infection. And after an injury, the tree begins producing this resin and sends it to the affected area in order to keep infection from spreading to healthy cells. This resin has been used for centuries by humans as a medicine, and many of the compounds it contains are known to have antibacterial, antiviral, antifungal, and antioxidant properties. And the resin is still heavily used today. It's popular in the cosmetic industry in anti-aging creams, and it's also being investigated by researchers for its anti-cancer properties. Unfortunately, this has led to overexploitation, putting this tree on the IUCN's red list of threatened species. Now, dragon's blood tree resin is not the only thing about this tree that's a conversation starter. That funky umbrella shape is worth talking about, too. The shape serves an important purpose for both the tree and the surrounding ecosystem. While most trees pull water from the soil, through their roots, and into their leaves, dragon's blood trees can do that in reverse. When water is scarce during times of drought, they can pull water out of the air, found in clouds and fog, and pass it down into the soil. Researchers estimate that a single tree adds several times more water into the soil than the local environment captures as rainfall. Losing a tree thus means losing a lot of water that is used by the local ecosystem. In addition, the loss of even one dragon's blood tree means the loss of many other species. That's because these trees act as an umbrella species. The umbrella analogy is really working out here, providing water, shelter, and food for other creatures in the area. Today, we have journeyed through a botanical wonderland where fantasy intersects with science and Dr. Seuss books come to life. While taxonomically speaking, there is no such thing as a tree, the evolutionary strategies plants have evolved for accessing light have given rise to a wild array of forms. But these trees aren't just botanical oddities. They are also important contributors to their ecosystems, providing shelter and nourishment, and even shaping the landscapes they inhabit. They also serve as a reminder of the importance of conservation efforts, with several species facing threats from climate change and overexploitation.